Hallelujah. Welcome to Amazing Grace. I am Pastor Kofi Tutu, here once again with you to share the incorruptible word of God. Today I have a very special friend with me, my bishop, as a matter of fact, Bishop E.O. Ansah, all the way from London, England. He's a founder and senior pastor of Kingdom Life Ministries International, with branches all over in Ghana, in other parts of Europe. You know, and in London, all over, man. And this is a very powerful man of God here with us today to share a very powerful message with us. So prepare yourself, get your pen and paper ready. Trust me, you're going to be blessed. So help me welcome on board on the show, Bishop Ansah.
Nice. How you doing, meeting Bishop? Beautiful.
Man, we've been such,
it's a new day.
We've been such privileged to have you today with us here at the studio. I know that my audience, you know, the last time we were here, we had an opportunity to have a program together, and it's been such a tremendous blessing. It's been receiving so much views, you know, and other social networks, and I know today is not going to be an exception. Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen.
So I know you have something for us today, so I'm not going to waste too much time. So I just, over to you, sir.
Hallelujah. Bless us. God bless you. Pastor Kofi Tutu, you know, I'm used to calling you Pastor Jerry.
Yes, you can.
And I know you're doing a good job blessing people through this network. And day by day, the anointing is increasing. Amen. Over your life. And there's coming a time, the testimonies that will pour in will be mind-blowing.
Amen.
Because I know you as a person, that you are the type who has a heart and a passion to get the unsaved saved. Amen. Believers edified, backsliders restored, and you are raising leaders. And I know there's somebody watching you who is moving from glory to glory, whose testimony you may not even lay hold of. Amen. They may not come to you. Mm-hmm. But you are blessing them in secret. Anyway, I have a word for you. Mm-hmm. Captioned "The Great Escape." Mm-hmm. We live in a world where we get entangled, we get cornered, we get blocked, we get intercepted. Sometimes we are caught up and held up in four walls of containment. Mm. And you are wondering, how am I going to get out of this situation? Mm. Sometimes it's a marital situation, it could be a financial situation, it could be a legal situation, sometimes it's your health, it could be something going on in your mind, it could be emotional imprisonment. But I came with the good news that says there is a way of escape for you. There came a time in David's life, he was trapped in caves, trapped in places he never expected to find himself. But God was always faithful. So there was a time he said, had it not been the Lord on our side, hey, let Israel see. If it was not God on our side, when men rose up against us, when they broke up against us like mighty wicked waters, if it wasn't God, we would have been in prison. But blessed be the Lord who didn't give us as prey to the teeth of our enemies. The snare they used for our feet is broken. We have escaped because our strength is in the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Who made heaven and earth.
Hallelujah.
There is a beautiful piece of scripture in Acts, the chapter of 5, reading from 17 to 23. Pastor Jerry just amplified that word of scripture, and we could stand on and be a blessing to our audience.
Hallelujah.
Somebody is going to be blessed. It's not too late to pick up the telephone and call somebody, urging them to view this program with you. You may not know you are connecting that person to an awesome destiny for this time. Let it flow.
Hallelujah. I'm reading from the book of Acts of the Apostles, the chapter of 5, the verse of 17 onwards. And it says, "Then the high priest rose up, and all they that were with him, which is the sect of the Sadducees, and were filled with indignation, and laid their hands on the apostles, and put them in the common prison. Then the angel of the Lord by night opened the prison doors, and brought them both, and said, Go, stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life. And when they heard that, they entered into the temple early in the morning and taught. But the high priest came, and they that were with him, and called the council together, and all the senate of the children of Israel, and sent to the prison to have them brought." Then the verse of 22. But then the officers came and found them not in the prison. They returned and said and told them, saying, the prison truly found we shut with all safety, and the keepers standing without before the doors. But when we had opened, we found no man within. Oh, hallelujah.
You know,
the door is shut.
That's it. Securely shut.
Securely shut. The security man or the warder or the prison guard were on guard.
They were in place.
In place, but yet there's nobody in the room. Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
This disappearing act has taken place.
This is what our God can do. Mm. It's not about the confinement they put you in. Mm-mm. It's not about how they hedge you in or hem you in, and they think your life is going to be rotten. Mm. You are in that hole. You are in that rat. Mm. And they think you will remain there forever. Yeah. That is why another subheading I gave to this word, the great escape, is your enemies shall never find you where they last left you.
Right, where they last left you.
That's it. Your enemies shall never find you where they last left you. Now, the apostles were put in prison. Mm-hmm. They didn't do any wrong. No. It's not every guy in prison that sinned. Mm-hmm. Or did wrong,
or committed any
any kind of crime. Mm-hmm. Life situations can place you where you don't belong.
Exactly.
In fact, prison is defined as to remain in confinement.
Yes, to be deprived of your personal
liberty,
you know, liberty
and freedom.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes in an involuntary way, mm-hmm. you didn't cause it, or it's not your will mm-hmm. to be there. Mm-hmm. Now, we can have spiritual prison. Mm-hmm. And we can have physical prison.
Yes.
Sometimes you are not put in the physical prison, but you
spiritually
you are
behind bars.
My
mentally
God.
You are behind bars.
Mentally you are behind bars. Mm. Emotionally you are behind bars. You are not yourself. Mm. You cannot even think straight. Mm. Things are beating you from the left and from the right. Let me tell you, maritally, you could be imprisoned. Mm. You are wedded to this man, married to this man, but you find yourself in the prison of your own house.
Of your own house.
My
and sometimes,
God.
And sometimes, according to the scripture, it was not something that they were put there by the authorities.
By the authorities.
By the authorities. You see, it's not something that even that they committed a crime or something, but just because of what they stand for, they were put in prison.
And that is why sometimes you don't have to say, what have I done? Mm. What did I do to the devil? What did I do to this man? Mm-mm. Because you can have physical enemies that are human beings. Mm. They hate you for no reason.
For no reason.
Sometimes they see the giftings, the grace, the talent in you, and they feel envious or jealous. And they have a way of coming at you, reporting you to authorities, saying bad and making derogatory statements about you. Mm-hmm. And you have to know how to compose yourself and comport yourself. Mm. Know for sure that you can have spiritual enemies. Mm. And sometimes your spiritual enemy will use a human entity to fight you.
Of course. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They always work through humans, yes.
And so they put these apostles in the common prison for no good reason. Mm. But God was good. Bible says, in the night, an angel of the Lord, not angels, just one angel was sent to unlock them from their prison house. They did it in such a way, the operation was carried out without men visibly and physically seeing what was going on. It means there are levels in vision. Mm-hmm. When you are serving this living God, there are things he may disallow people to see. Mm. God has hidden us from the sight of some enemies. Mm, and they will not be able to see how we move from A to B and how we excel or how we go on higher.
It's beyond them.
My goodness.
It's something they cannot comprehend. See, it's so amazing that they said, we went there. As we got there, the door is locked, all right.
The door is locked, all right.
The security guard is on guard, all right.
They are there.
But there's nobody in the room.
There was a rescue mission beyond their ken, beyond their experience, beyond their sight. This is the kind of God we serve.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
They never saw when it happened. Mm-mm. Maybe a deep sleep fell on them.
Upon them.
But our God carries a master key.
And wouldn't they even check in the morning when they woke up to make sure that their people are in prison?
Because the operation was carried out from another angle.
Hallelujah.
A miracle is the setting aside of a lower law by a higher law.
That's right. A setting aside of a lower law.
Of a lower law by a higher law.
Haha.
Okay. So when God does his things, you cannot depict with your human mind. Mm-mm. In fact, Mary, when the angel Gabriel announced to Mary that you shall conceive and give birth to a son, his name shall be called Jesus, for he shall be great. Mm. Mary said, but how can this be?
To the human mind, it was impossible.
I'm just engaged. I'm not yet married. Mm-hmm. I haven't slept with my husband. How can it be? And the angel Gabriel answered Mary that this one is not something earthly beings Mm-mm. have to figure out Mm-mm. how it's going to happen.
No.
Because Bible says, and Mary considered it in his mind, what kind of salutation this is.
Mm-hmm.
Then the angel said, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, Mary, and the power of the Most High shall overshadow you. There is a system heaven has in place that will override earthly systems.
Oh my
you
God.
Don't need a man for help. Mm-mm. God will create that spiritual spermatozoa.
My
God.
Hallelujah.
That will collide with the egg of your womb and there shall be conception.
Mm-hmm.
You see, we must believe.
That's
Pastor
it.
Pastor Jerry,
that's
we
it.
Must come to the place of believing God for the supernatural.
For the supernatural.
The moment a Christian loses faith in the supernatural,
you are no longer a Christian.
Now, did you read the Bible that it was the sect called the Sadducees?
The Sadducees.
They don't believe in spiritual things.
Mm-mm-mm.
So they were incensed by the way these disciples kept talking about a spirit entity called Jesus, whom we know we have killed, who we know is dead.
Mm-hmm.
So they were indignant because these disciples kept speaking things in the realms of the spirit.
Yeah, because it says there right there in the verse of 17 that they were filled with indignation.
That's what they did.
They were
filled and with so they pounced on them, cast them into prison, not knowing that the angel of the Lord came that same night, rescued them out of the prison. They were keeping an empty prison.
Without even the knowledge.
They had the security locks over an empty space. The apostles left the prison based on the rescue mission that the angel brought, and they went back to the place where they were originally and they spoke the word of God.
Hallelujah. That reminds me, That reminds me of, you remember the scripture when Jesus, when he resurrected, and when he appeared, you know, to the disciples, when they were in a room.
That's it.
The door was locked.
That's it.
They didn't realize or didn't see where he came from.
Yes.
All they know, he was right in their middle. Standing in the middle of, in the center of them. And they thought maybe they were seeing a ghost. Or an angel. He said, no, I'm not a ghost. Give me bread and fish. Give me some sandwich. And he ate it right in their presence.
Hallelujah.
To show to them that I am not a spirit. I'm a human being like you.
The resurrected body is awesome. You are talking Absolutely. About the wonders of the resurrected body. That's the kind of body angels have.
Mm.
It can disappear and it can appear. Hallelujah. Yet it is solid.
It's solid.
You know, it's beyond our natural mind.
Still can't
it's
get it.
Beyond our care.
Just
and the joy
out.
Is that's the kind of body you and I will have.
Hallelujah.
When the we end. Are when we are resurrected.
The redeemed body. Yes.
When the redeemed body comes, that's what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Now that's the kind no sickness can be held in.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing can hold. Death has no power over such a body.
Yeah.
So Jesus stormed their midst. Didn't have to knock
Mm-mm.
for them to open the door.
No.
He just stepped in, and he tell them, hold me. I'm not a spirit. I'm flesh and blood.
Like you.
I'm flesh and bone.
Yes.
And the spirit has no body. So Jesus authenticated the reality of the spirit world.
Mm-hmm.
That they carry no bodies.
They carry no bodies.
Yet they have mind,
and all of
will,
that.
Emotions, and all of that.
Yeah.
And this is why we are here. To let somebody know that spiritually you may have enemies as well as physically, but your enemies shall never find you where they last left you. They thought the apostles will rot in that prison house, yet there was a rescue mission that heaven had organized on their behalf. We came to tell you that God is working on your case.
Hallelujah.
It may be a law case, a suitcase, it could be something marital, it could be something financial, it could be something going on in your workplace. You feel imprisoned. In fact, you don't understand why of late you feel so heavy and weighed down, but God says, I'm going to get you out of that prison. That was Jesus's mission, part of his mission. You read the Isaiah. Book of Isaiah, the chapter of 61. Read the first three verses.
Isaiah chapter 61, reading from the verse of 1 to 3. Say, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me.
The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me.
Because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek.
The Lord has anointed me, rubbed his Spirit on me, endued me with power from on high to minister the gospel. Because the gospel must not only be in words, it must be backed by the power of the Holy
Manifestation,
Spirit.
Manifestation, demonstration. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted.
That's it.
To proclaim liberty to the captives.
That's it.
To proclaim liberty to the captives.
To proclaim, to bind up the brokenhearted means if your heart is broken by whatever situation, this master will pick up the broken pieces,
and bind it together,
bind them together with the glue of the anointing,
for
and then rub his oil on and place it back into your chest cavity for you to function again.
Again.
I've seen many brokenhearted come to God and they are healed.
Hallelujah. Of course.
You could have been disappointed by a man you placed your confidence in. You put your trust in somebody, they let you down. Because Bible says the arm of flesh will fail you. But God says, I will pick up the broken pieces so you will function again. Somebody is watching us. You will function again.
Hallelujah.
You will not go down the drain. God lifts you up. Ministry is about lifting people up.
Hallelujah.
He says to set the captives free.
And the opening of the prison to them that are bound.
Hallelujah. Oh,
the opening of the prison to them that are bound.
Hallelujah.
So the Lord is in the business of opening
prison doors
out of their confinement.
Hallelujah.
See, even though you may be in some mental prison, you can be in some emotional prison, you can be in one kind of prison, but the Lord is in the business of setting people loose, opening doors, prison doors to set you free. Whatever prison that you are in, let me tell you that God or Jesus is in the business of setting you free. All you have to do is just believe that he came to set the captives free. He came to deliver those that are bound out of your bondage. So no matter what you are going through, Jesus is in the business.
Hallelujah.
Oh, my brother, Pastor, you charge me up, so Bishop.
Amen.
You charge me up.
Preach on. Because, you know, there are people who think that the prison house of the state or of the county is the only place that can lock you up. Sometimes you are not under any four walls of confinement, yet in the realms of the spirit, you are locked up.
You are locked up.
There is the prison of your body, infested with sickness, malady, ailments. Today, Jesus has the power to loose you.
Hallelujah. In one of your books, I forget which one of them, in one of your books, you made mention of them. You said that the prison doors
are open.
No, they are not mental, but they are mental. I forget, there's a quotation like that.
That I said, that is not just held by metals, but it could be held by mentals.
Mental.
That's it.
See, the doors, no, the containment, anyway.
That's the way it is.
Yeah, they say the containment of your prison or something is not metal, but mental. Oh, I forget. In one of your books, I forget which one.
That's the way it is.
Yeah.
So you could be walking freely,
but mentally,
out there,
you are in
but
prison.
Mentally you are clamped down.
Down.
Emotionally, you've been clamped down.
Yeah.
Don't dare commit suicide. It's an emotional imprisonment that tells you there is a no escape situation for you. But we brought the message of great escape.
Hallelujah.
that the master has the power. He's got the master key to unlock you.
To unlock you
from that situation.
There's nothing that you have to do about it. All you have to do is just believe.
Do you know that some people have stayed in a job, in one position, in one place for all their lives? That's imprisonment.
Imprisonment, of course.
You need to rise up.
Of course.
You need to go forward.
You need to grow.
Anything in the without name growth of is Jesus, hallelujah. You are unlocked from that prison house.
Hallelujah.
You will not be in one place. You go forward.
That's right.
Receive growth. Progress. Mm-hmm. Receive spiritual progress. Mm. Receive power to break free from the lines of limitation. Those four walls of containment will not hold you any longer. Break free and go like a bird out of the snare of the fowler. The snare is broken.
The snare is broken. You see, today I was, when we were coming, and before I came, I was coming to pick you up. The Lord just dropped this scripture, in my spirit. And I opened the Bible and I was reading it. And I'm like, wow, many a times you quote this scripture, Isaiah 54, the verse of 17. And the Lord said to me, you quote it, but you don't quote the whole thing. Right? He says, I'm going to read that scripture, to bring it up to what we're saying. Isaiah chapter 54, the verse of 17. It says that no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper, and every tongue that shall rise up against thee in judgment, thou shalt condemn. And most times, many a time, about 90% of the time, you quote this scripture and leave it right there. But Bishop, the remaining part of the verse holds the key to all of that. It says, this is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord.
That's it.
So the reason why no weapon formed against you shall prosper is because you are the servant of the Lord, and your righteousness, or the reason why you are considered righteous, is not something that you did, but because of what God himself have done.
That's it.
If you compare this to what we're talking about, the weapon that was formed against Peter, being put in prison, something that he didn't even do.
That's it.
Didn't commit no sin. But whilst he was there, the weapon did not prevail against him. Why? Because God sent his own angel to get him out. Why? Because he was a servant of the Lord.
Hallelujah. And sometimes servants, they commit blunder. They sin. They blow it. Yet God will not leave them to the prey. As prey to the teeth of their enemies. As long as you come to repentance and you believe in the saving grace of God, mercy will rescue you.
Hallelujah.
So there's a verse in Isaiah, the book of Isaiah, that says, shall the captive of the mighty be delivered? That means, shall the lawful captive
be delivered?
They were wrong.
Isaiah 49.
That's it.
My favorite one.
49, 24. And 25 also.
Yeah, Isaiah 49. Yes, 24.
That's it.
Isaiah 49, 24 says, shall the prey be taken from the mighty, or the lawful captive delivered?
That's it. Lawful captive means they committed some blunder and they were captured.
Oh, hallelujah.
Put in prison. Will they be delivered? God delivered the answer. Read on.
And then the verse of 25 says, but that seeth the Lord.
But thus saith the
Lord. Even the captives of the mighty shall be taken away, and the prey of the terrible shall be delivered.
That's it.
For I will contend with him that contended with thee, and I will save thy children. Oh, hallelujah. This is my God.
There is a rescue mission that God has packaged for our delivery to the people. Your son is coming out of that prison house.
That's right.
I remember once upon a time I was ministering in church back in London, and I spoke into a lady's life that I see that your son is imprisoned. Never knew that lady, but the word of knowledge was active and strong. And the woman said, for 6 years, Bishop, my son has been in prison. I said, this year, the Lord is bringing about a rescue.
Hallelujah.
She said to me later on, when the son was released, it was a miraculous release. They came out saying he had been comporting himself. He was brilliant through the seminars they were holding. A boy like that should not be kept in prison. I'm sure it was something to do with credit card fraud. And for some supernatural means, the superintendent of the prison said the boy should be released.
Hallelujah.
You cannot find words to explain what God does in the realms of the spirit that manifest in the flesh.
Yes.
The woman said to me later on, Bishop, there was no way I could believe, because we are dealing with a legal system and we are dealing with written documents. So I said to myself,
facts against him is unsurmountable, that there's no way. But you see, people forget that when you're dealing with God, there's no such thing as facts. You talking about facts, he's talking about truth that will override the facts.
Hallelujah.
You know, so see, when God is at work, he's a very merciful God. See, the difference between mercy and grace. Mercy is what something that you have done and you are guilty of being punished, but yet he'll be merciful to you.
That's it.
And grace is something that you didn't even do at all, but he will give it to you.
That's it.
You don't deserve to have it.
That's it.
See, our God is gracious. Our God is merciful. Either way, you committed, you done something wrong, he said, I am a merciful God. I will forgive you.
Hallelujah.
He will have mercy on you. If you done something so wicked, don't condemn yourself. Remember, there's therefore now no condemnation in those that are in Christ Jesus. Know that Jesus loves you. No matter what you've done. The other day somebody said, I don't believe God will ever forgive me. What have you done that God cannot forgive you? Every prison that you are in, that self-imprisonment that you have put yourself in, we are here to tell you today that Jesus can set you free.
Hallelujah. Somebody be our watching us.
To, yes, finish
and
it off.
It's the fruit of your womb. You've been married for how long? Yet there is no issue. You find yourself in the prison of your fertility, or prison of infertility. May you be released in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah. I know you've been blessed. Unfortunately, the time has come for us to bring this to an end. So you stay tuned. Next week, I'll meet you same time. Bye-bye.